my black people. It's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving.
Warning. Stand by for countdown. Prepare audience for maximum impact. Full immersion begins in.
Something that I don't see. What can you learn from a bum, Omar? Shamsuddin? What I learned from a bum, maybe it's what not to do.
Nobody takes down Angus Snuff Nuff 7 easy. There's a reason why, after 100 channels destroyed, Angus Snuff Nuff 7 is still here. There's a reason why nobody wanna get in a beef with Angus Snuff Nuff 7. But you don't take me seriously.
See, they say that Angus Snuff Nuff 7 don't care about the people. But Angus Snuff Nuff 7 cares about the people because I'm bold enough to tell you the truth, and I don't give a damn if you give me a dime. I'm not looking for your money.
We are in a state of emergency.
Prejudice. Wrote a song about it? Like to hear it? Here it go.
Free your mind. This is a story about control. My control. Control of what I say and control of what I do. And this time I'm gonna do it my way. I hope you enjoy this as much as I do. Are we ready? I am. 'Cause it's all about control. And I've got lots of it.
What made me bring this up is an interaction I had with one of my nephews. 5 or 6 years old, something like that. Children. But I was 5 or 6 years old too at one time. And people make excuses for these children's ill behavior. Oh, he's just a baby. I was a baby too. 5, 6 years old. But the children are a reflection of their parents. And a lot of these parents treat these children like that's their friend. That's your child that is not a friend. That child is only 5, 6 years old. When you said sit your ass down, that child's supposed to tell you where you want me to sit. That's what you're supposed to get out of your child. These children, you said, sit down. No. Woo! I remember that child told me that. Time for you to go home. Now, see, I was 5, 6 years old, too. And I'm going to tell you, in my generation, a lot of us, some of us had good parents, some of us had terrible parents. But also, you, even as a child, you should know certain things. A lot of these children don't think at all. And a lot of it comes from being spoiled. That's going to get them in trouble. You think that's cute? Spoiling these children, that's doing them a disservice. They need to obey. They're children. You are the adult. Because the world is not going to spoil them. The world will put a bullet in their head. Which that's what you have been finding out within the last of these generations. You disrespect authority. Authority put a bullet in your head. You disrespect another child, put a bullet in your head. The world don't give a damn about your child. And your child has this privilege complex. Like somebody, oh, nobody owe you nothing. And the world will show you that. They'll put you in the morgue. Don't have to worry about you no more. I was a child too. And my mother didn't have to sit down with us, respect the adults and stuff. My mother didn't have to go around doing all that. It's certain things that we just done. I respect the older children. Never mind the adults. It's just something I did. Because I'm a child. They're bigger than me. You got a child 6 years old telling grown people, I ain't going to do that. No. Woo. Because you spoil them. But I bet that child would do whatever a pedophile want them to do, because that pedophile kicked your ass. Your child would do with a pedophile, plus your child gonna give up the booty. We spoil these children. These children don't do what you say. You are in the park. And there's a car coming. And you tell that child, don't go out there. A car coming. No. Then the child runs out there and get hit by the car. And the child don't die. The child is paralyzed from the neck down. You wish the child was dead. Now you got to take care of this child. Child can't do a damn thing for you. Can't do a damn thing for him or herself. All because you can't control your child. Whose fault is it? It was a lady this week. The jury found her guilty because she gave her crazy ass son a gun. The father's child is coming next. Here you are. You know your child is crazy as hell. And you gonna get, you gonna go and show them how to shoot the gun. Take them out to the range and give them a gun for their birthday, whatever the hell it was. And then they go to the school and shot up with 7 people or whatever. The parent knew their child was crazy. Whose fault is it? It's still the child's fault, of course. They done it. Look at the parents. Don't you think that the parents should be held responsible? Even we as grown people, you got somebody in your house you know is a dingbat, and they have a gun, and you sit back and don't open your mouth. Shouldn't you be held responsible? Because you knew something was going to go down. That person had a weapon. You know that person is a dingbat. And you don't do nothing. Don't just. I can't snitch on my friend. I can't snitch on my mama. I know my mama crazy, but I don't think she would do that. Your mama is crazy. You know it is. She got a gun. She just went out here talking crazy stuff. So now you got 30 people dead. And you knew your mom was crazy running around with a gun. At least a child. Who in their right mind would give a gun to their child like that? And you don't have no control over the gun. These people talk about the single mothers. Oh, he come from a two-parent household, y'all. A two-parent household? You, these Negroes on here? Single mothers is bad mothers. We need, all of us, we need to come from a two-parent household. Mind you, my position is that's the best thing for us. Two-parent household. Mother and father. There's nothing wrong with that. But don't you run around here and degrade and make mockery of single mothers, you piece of trash. This killer came from a two-parent household. A jury found his mother guilty. An accessory to the murder. What is this? She got manslaughter charges? And the father, two-parent household. Now what you gonna say? It wasn't a single mother. Mostly, a lot of these killers come from two-parent household. These serial killers. They come from two-parent household. Single mothers, that don't make any difference. It's the quality of the parents, not the quantity. I wonder how many single mothers are giving their children, knowing their child is crazy. Because I know a lot of black mothers, when I was growing up, they know their sons, they weren't going to give their children no damn gun. Hell, that child, two-parent household, I heard a few months ago, I think it was sometime late last year, a former NBA player, two-parent household, their son shot them. I believe they survived. Two-parent household. What you gotta say, son? And there's a lot of examples of people coming from two-parent household. Murderers, killers, rapists. That don't solve nothing because I came from a two-parent household. That don't solve your problem in America. Because your problem has nothing to do with that. The root of our problem in this country really comes from the so-called men that don't want to be men. You don't stand up as a man. You're called a man by default. So take your happy ass. I know you don't want to hear that. Take your happy ass where somebody can give you a ball. Give you a ball to play with. Stroke your nuts. That's not going to happen here. want to hear what I say because you emotional. You ain't saying it right. I've never been around men. There's men I talked to for years. I mean, yeah, not 1 year, not 2 years. I mean, there's men that I have known for years. But because I don't get with their program, they cry and they gone. Because they want me to be a certain way. You knew what I was when your ass met me. They all met me via social media since 2007. I did not praise Malcolm X. I did not do that. I'm not a Muslim. I never was blackity black. I never was. I never claimed to be pro-black, black, all this blackity black stuff. I never claimed none of that stuff. I used to talk about white people more back in the day. But it wasn't because of I'm blackity black and black man is God and I'm superior black folks and Egypt. That's not why. I was talking about simple justice. How we have been done wrong in this country. I wasn't talking all that blackity black stuff. I'm a god, I'm a warrior, and all that foolishness. I never talked like that. And I never claimed to be an African. I never claimed that. That's never really been a part of me because I was a Muslim under the teachings of Elijah Muhammad. Elijah Muhammad did not teach that. Elijah Muhammad taught us that we came from the tribe of Shabazz. He did not teach that we're some kind of Africans. And he did not teach Pan-Africanism. Elijah Muhammad did not teach that. So that really wasn't a part of me anyway. I've never been around such emotional men. What the hell wrong with y'all? But you a warrior. How the hell are you a warrior and you a god? And you can't handle the opinion or the belief of another person. What kind of God are you? What kind of warrior? You can't even handle words, let alone bullets and bombs dropping on your ass and swords and knives or whatever is out there, wherever you have to find yourself with in wartime. So if the men aren't strong, how can you expect the women and the children to be strong? They are a reflection. So whatever you bad you have to say about women, however bad you have to have you say about children, it's a reflection of our failure as a man in this country. Whether you like it or not. Not as an individual, but as a gender. But the sad thing is, if our gender is a failure, it don't make no difference what you do as an individual, you're still a failure. So no matter what Jay-Z do, if black men are nothing but crackheads and drunks, it don't make no difference. And plus, Jay-Z drank a little bit. He'd be out there, you know, you see Jay-Z with the bottle turned up. See, I told you black men ain't no more drunks and crackhead. And Jay-Z probably do little drugs too. He can handle his drugs. He's not a drug addict. He probably do a little drugs. Smoke his cigar. Next week, Jay-Z be talking about he got lung cancer, some kind of cancer from his years of caviar and that expensive vodka, going to Super Bowl games, playing with balls. Woo! Just because you're a child don't mean you don't have common sense. Just because you're a child don't mean that you can't think. We talk about single parents. We talk about the two-parent household. But what about those of us who basically raised ourselves? Shout out to our sister Ann. I wish she was here. Because you can have parents in your house. That don't mean you being raised. Just because people in your house, your mother and father, don't mean you had parents. So what, you come from a two-parent household? So what because you come from a single mother? That don't mean you had parents. There are many of us, we raise ourselves. I had a mother in the house. I had father in the house. I had grown people in the house. I raised myself. So that means I had to have some kind of common sense. Back in the day, children used to leave home at 11, 14 years old and leave home. They couldn't have to be that stupid, they would never make it.
I do want to say something right now. There is a YouTuber who has really got in my heart, and that is Angel SnubNub7. He reminds me a lot of my father. My father died last year of a heart attack, and Angel SnubNub7.
Brothers and sisters, this is Tangie Cox, the Black Sheep, and I am propositioning you to entertain just a little while of being in reality. And this is gonna hurt soul sisters and brothers, because a lot of us cannot accept reality. I empower you to, for 1 year, to subscribe to the Reality Temple on Earth. And at the end of 12 months, draw your conclusion of what have you learned in that amount of time. I empower you. You will never, ever, ever think, feel, or entertain nonsense ever again, period. I would like to see my soul sisters and brothers awaken. This requires time. You need to spend about a year watching, researching, and looking. The Reality Temple on Earth is life-changing, and I stand on that.
Give me some fear! Give me some-
myself. Even with all the oppression, we were accomplishing things. Far greater than the black and blacks have done. They've done very little. Except bring you the teaching, the belief. Because that's all teachings is, I believe. We don't need to believe no more. We need to know.
Right, it's almost like a royalty there, a royalty hierarchy.
You know, all this obsession with certain individuals. I've never been fanatical over nobody. I always admire you for your talent, and I like your talent, but I've never been fanatical over nobody. Ain't nobody more important than me. If I'm gonna be fanatical over anybody, it's gonna be my mama. If I'm gonna be fanatical over anybody, you know, all these people, you know, I don't care how to, I'm not fanatical over nobody. You special and you divine. You don't mean nothing to me. Now, when I was with Minister Farrakhan, a lot of celebrities came out to the meetings or whatever. And I was introduced and shook hands and met a few celebrities or whatever. But I saw them as nothing but ordinary people. You know, just like, I'm pretty sure you heard my videos. You know, I like this sister right here, Terry Ellis. And I was able to meet her. I even kissed her hand in a concert. She's just a sister. If she was just an ordinary sister down the block, that's all I see her as. She would be, if she lived down the block, She's a sister that I'm attracted to. I would want to talk to her, blah, blah. But just because she's a singer and got this fame, that don't mean a damn thing to me. She's just a person. She's just a human being. And within the next 30 years, she'd probably be dead. Go ahead, bro.
No, I was about to say, but you see, they following Elijah Muhammad's thought process. You see, Elijah Muhammad was... You know, if you take it back, you know, this is not too long after slavery. He living in some country backwoods part of Georgia, and some damn foreigner man come to him with all these strange teachings. Elijah Muhammad saw him as a god, even though he wasn't a god. Elijah Muhammad saw that man as a god. You know, this man in the back country woods of Georgia ain't never heard nobody talk about all this type of stuff. This dude must be a god. He look different. He come with all this different knowledge. He must be a god. Elijah Muhammad is on tape saying, you know, they always say that Master Farid Muhammad, which is funny, they call him Master, seeing as how he's half white. But they always say that they always say that he's God in person. Elijah Muhammad is on tape saying at the end of an interview that Farid Muhammad didn't like Elijah Muhammad teaching that he was God in person, because Farid Muhammad never said that, according to Elijah Muhammad. And he didn't like when Elijah Muhammad used to say that. But Elijah Muhammad continued saying that because in his mind, in the mind of Elijah Muhammad, Farid Muhammad was God in his mind. Exactly. And and from there on, the Nation of Islam just took on that thought process. But in all reality, Farid Muhammad is some damn mixed breed foreigner who was just reading a bunch of damn books from this country to this country, flip-flopping all around the damn place, because he used to be in the Morris Science Temple of America, because I saw a damn picture with him in the assembly, and it is him. That one picture that they try to say that's not Farid Muhammad with the reading the book with the hair slicked back, that's him. That's him. They don't want it to be him because he looks so white, but that's him. Because like you said, the Detroit Police Department, he been locked up for plenty of times. They got his name and pictures. That's him. And that, yeah. And that's how I knew that. And that's how I knew that was him on that Morris, in that picture in the assembly with the Morris Science Temple of America. But he was just a foreigner going around from different countries, reading different books into occult sciences. And he brought that to some backwards country man in Georgia. And that man became a leader and spread it to all the people here. And that, and that's that.
I mean, it's just some religious. I mean, the religion, what it done for these people is what a lot of religion does happen. I mean, it makes you feel good. You got to give it its credit, because what it does, it'll take a person that's down and out and you oppressed. Here comes somebody telling you that you God. You know, you God of the universe, and you're so great and you're so special. Yeah, it's very uplifting.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the power. All religions do that. Religion will come to you when you're down and out, when you're at your worst, and mm-hmm. and hype you up. That's what religions do. Then, of course, another thing that they do too, when you get all hyped up like that, they say, now, will you put your money in the basket?
You know? Yeah.
What you going to do for me now?
I was going to add on to that. What you notice with a lot of religions, especially Muslim, if you ever notice, like you said, it feels good to the people who are kind of mentally down. You ever notice, yeah, like it spreads the fastest in prison?
Yeah.
Why is it that it spreads fast in prison or among the poverty or minority classes and people? Rich people not converting to Islam in record numbers. If it's so true. It's something about it that only appeals to people that are what you would consider oppressed.
Exactly. Why? Because if that was the case, why aren't all these rich people giving all their money to these folks? You know, Jay-Z and Beyonce, who they giving their money to, or Oprah, or, you know, or Barack Obama? They're not giving their money to all these different churches and stuff. They're keeping their money in their pocket.
Mm-hmm.
Poor people, the oppressed, the downtrodden, giving their money to these type of folks.
Mm-hmm. And now, another thing about it. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm just saying, these people, these religions, that's who they target.
Mm-hmm.
Target you when you are at your lowest. It gives you that spirit. That's why they would tell you. And see, that's why it's very dangerous, because a lot of these people would tell you that this teaching saved my life. No, what would save your life if you was able to think for yourself? That's what would have saved your life. But they give the credit to these teachings that save their life. And since these teachings save their life, they willing to kill you for speaking against it, because it saved their life.
Right.
And that's what makes this religious stuff dangerous, because they will attack anything that threatens their belief system, that exposes their belief system. And then a lot of folks don't want to feel stupid, because they know that what a lot of things that they hear is true. But you make them feel stupid, so I'm going to bust you. I don't want to hear it. I don't want to feel stupid, so I feel if I kill you, it's going to stop. But I want to tell y'all out there, it's not going to stop.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to stop. Slowly but surely, these ancient, what they call a primordial, prehistoric belief system, they're going to fade away. Because we're just getting too smart. We're too technical to continue to believe this. And after thousands of years gone by, it's quite obvious these things aren't going to come true. What you going to wait? It's going to be the year 30,000 and you still saying the same garbage? Right. It's got to stop sooner or later. It's got to.
Right. Now what they start to say now is, well, hey, it don't hurt to believe. You might not know. You don't know. It won't hurt to believe. Because they you unbeat them down to an argument so bad that all they can just say now is, well, it don't hurt to believe. What do you gain or lose from believing?
Well, actually, it do hurt to believe. Actually, it do.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're putting your faith and hope into something that's not real. It's never going to happen. So you're wasting mm-hmm. your time. And what makes things so worse is that you don't keep it to yourself. You're going to spread those lies to innocent children and other naive mm-hmm. folks. You're not going to keep it to yourself. Now, I would give a lot of Jewish people credit, because I heard Jews don't go around trying to convert nobody to nothing. They keep their crap to themselves. They're not out here trying to convert people to Judaism or whatever. But you got all these other faiths. They out here trying to convert people and get them whatever. Leave people alone. Matter mm-hmm. of fact, if you keep it to yourself, nobody won't have nothing to say, because they don't hear your voice. But you come out here in the public and you want to tell this to other folks. Well, it's going to get backlash now. It's going to get backlash. Those days are mm-hmm. over. Matter of fact, it was happening. They was getting backlash way back in the day. But back in the day, they would outright kill people like you and me.
Mm-hmm.
They would mm-hmm. ostracize people like you and me. They would make mockery of people like you and me. And they would murder people like you and me for speaking out against these teachers, because this is what the king or the rulers want us to believe. And mm-hmm. this has been passed down for generation to generation. It's part of our tradition. Well, we need to traditionally break it up, because it's a damn lie. It's all fake and fraud.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And going back to what you were saying about Elijah Muhammad, and I heard a tape where Elijah Muhammad said, he asked Farid Muhammad, "Are you God?" And he mm-hmm. said that Farid Muhammad never answered him. So he assumed that he was right.
I heard that. Yeah, I remember that. I think I remember that.
And if you go back and study and look at all the teachings of Farid Muhammad before Elijah Muhammad, he don't teach that he's God in person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He never taught that.
Nope. I never heard him mention that, or nothing about him saying that he was actually God. Nope.
No, he didn't teach that. The original name of the Nation of Islam was Allah's Temple of Islam or something like that. I think mm-hmm. that was the original name.
Mm-hmm.
And Farid Muhammad was the leader. He was the one that got that together. There was no teaching where he was saying that he was God.
Are you familiar where, I'm not sure if this was him or not, but I think when that Farid Muhammad first came to Detroit or not, I think this was him. You ever heard about the story about the voodoo house?
Yeah. Yeah. One of the, one of his followers. See, that was part of the teaching. That was part of his teaching.
Yeah.
About human sacrifice.
Yeah, because that's what I'm saying. Farid Muhammad was reading all these type of books from all these different countries, almost like he was into occult practices almost.
Yeah, I forgot.
But yeah, what was it? One of his followers had beheaded somebody as a sacrifice or something?
Yeah. I don't think he beheaded. I think it was like heart sacrifice or something. Put him on a pew and split him open or something like that.
Hmm.
Matter of fact, that's what got Farid Muhammad in trouble when that happened. They was doing all right.
Really?
To that man did that. That's what messed up the whole Islam thing that he was doing. That what messed the whole thing up. Got the police involved in that situation. They was doing just fine. I mean, they didn't like them, but they tolerated that movement. But when that happened, that's what brought in the police. But that was part of his teaching, because I saw some of the literature. Before Elijah Muhammad, when Farid Muhammad was in charge, and he was talking about human sacrifice, and one of the believers decided to do it.
Really?
I want to go back to this thing. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, and I remember when I was doing my research on Farid Muhammad, one of the places he got his teachings from, that he was supposed to be from British India. Now, I noticed with some of the stuff he was teaching in British India, it was this other guy, I forgot his name at the time, where he claimed that he was the second coming of Jesus. And ironically, this dude, who was an Arab, claiming that he's the second coming of Jesus, ironically, this dude was teaching the same thing, ironically, that was similar to what Farid Muhammad was teaching. And ironically, they come from the same area.
And the Quran that they suggest that we read is translated, I believe, not from Arabs, because you know that the original Quran is supposed to be Arabic, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's translated from people that's not even Arabic, but they come from Pakistan. They're not Arabs like that. I don't know exactly if I'm explaining it right, but they're not Arabs.
It's translated from people. They aren't from Arabia, but some other little surrounding country. Yeah. So and in the Quran it says that the Arabs are the masters of the Arabic language. So how in the hell do we know that the people who's converting it who aren't Arabs know it right? When they're saying only the Arabs are the master of the Arab language, and hell, they barely even, they still say that they don't even got it right.
Exactly. But these are the things that we get caught, and see, what Malcolm X did, unfortunately, he didn't get an opportunity to really express himself. You know, he was murdered. But what Malcolm did, one of the smart things that Malcolm did do, he split his organization into two parts. There was a part just for the like liberation and the struggle, and there was a part just for spiritual religious belief. He knew that keeping them together, you're not going to accomplish nothing, because as we know, religion, that type of, or something religious like, is very divisive, because you have those things like Pan-Africanism. Pan-Africanism is not considered a religion, but in reality it is. Because there's a lot of beliefs that goes along with it. It's treated like a religion now, something that people believe.
Mm-hmm.
And anything that you have to believe in, something like that, is very divisive.
Mm-hmm.
So Malcolm was smart enough to understand to separate church from state.
Mm-hmm.
Because those things are very, those type of things, religion is very divisive.
There's been so many things that's held us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go, and where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're putting our show together, we're polishing up our act. And if you've ever been held down before, I know you refuse to be held down anymore. Don't you let nothing, nothing stand in your way. I want y'all to listen, listen to every word I say, every word I say. Ain't no stopping us now. We're on the move.
Nobody want to come here. It's because of y'all. Tell y'all the truth. Y'all are the most boring saints I've ever been around. Just gotta tell y'all this. If Bishop not gonna say it, I will tell y'all. Y'all are the most boring people I have ever been around in my life. I get dreadful every time it's time to worship with y'all, because y'all don't bring nothing to the table. I'm tired of bringing stuff to the table, and none of y'all got nothing to bring. Y'all worried about stuff that happened yesterday, wasting time. Y'all worried about stuff that don't even matter, wasting time. My new attitude is, if you're not going to come to church to worship, stay home. And I say this all the time. I don't need none of y'all. love everyone in here. I love everyone. I don't need not any one of y'all in here. At all. Y'all don't do nothing for me, but look at me while I'm saying it anyhow. Y'all are a bunch of boring, dead people. And I swear to God, I swear on everything I love. If it don't change, y'all not gonna see any benefit from the Lord. If y'all cannot worship with song, we're not even talking about listening to the word. We're talking about praise and worship. If y'all can't even listen to songs and be happy that someone's taking their time out to sing for y'all, and mind you, I don't get paid for this. So I really just sing to y'all for my benefits. And just for y'all to look real ugly and stupid, I'm tired of church for wasting my time, Mark.
And interested in black people, let us sit down and find out how we can get together in one direction against one enemy and accomplish this job overnight.
When soul singer and black activist Sam Cooke wrote the lyrics to his song, A Change Is Gonna Come, it was very direct and to the point. With some changes to it, the song was still digestible. In the year 2019, black folks continue to go through the change rather than direct the change. A community activist named Talik Ibn Rod has made an appeal similar to what Sam Cooke was asking for. A change. It's said that the meek shall inherit the earth. We ask when. When will the landlords give the meek a free lease? Mr. Ibn Rod is humbly asking for the state of Mississippi. This is Dusty Basement Studios, and we approve of this message.
The Mississippi campaign represents everything that you claim that you want. The beginning of an all-black independent nation. The ability to control your own resources. Your politics, the law, be able to do your own thing for a change, create an economy, create and produce goods that Africa or anybody on the planet would want. You're fake, you don't want to do nothing. 3 hours talking about the Mississippi campaign.
So you're soul brother, number one.
I was a little boy, and I asked my mother, grandfather, uncles. I was a little boy when I began to learn what Jim Crow was. I began to learn what was going on in the South. And I learned about Dr. King. That was the first person I learned about. And by the time I learned about Dr. King, he was passed. He was assassinated in 1968. But I asked my people, what did y'all do to help? I'm ready to fight. It reminds me, matter of fact, this is the 50th anniversary of Good Times. Ain't we lucky? The Super Bowl, y'all. Ain't we lucky we got them? Do, 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 do. Good time. Super Bowl, y'all. Yeah, well, you shut up so I can go watch the... It's time for the Super Bowl. I want to see them play with some balls. This is the 50th anniversary of Good Time. And if you notice, Michael Evans, they never took little Michael serious. He was somebody to laugh at. Oh, that's Michael. He's pro-blackity black this, and that's Michael. The whole family. Nobody could get with what Michael was on. He was a little boy. He was a little boy. And this is the way it was, really, us as a people. A few people stood up. And the rest was Christian, like Florida and James and Thelma and JJ and Wilona. They didn't care about the struggle. They laughed at my little Michael. When I first saw Good Times, I took Michael real serious. And I'm like, what are they laughing at? Why are they laughing at Michael for? But see, if it wasn't for that mindset of Michael, if it wasn't for the mindset of Dr. King and the Black Panthers, Huey P. Newton and Elvis Cleavage and all, if it wasn't for that mindset, where would we be? Where would we be at? But he's a subject of laughter. What is Michael doing funny? What's hilarious? So I asked my family, what did we do? What did y'all do for the struggle? Ain't do nothing. But Thelma and JJ and Florida and Wilona and James and all the Negroes benefit from the struggle, but didn't do a damn thing. Even to this day. Even to this day. All our people, rappers and singers and CEOs or whatever, I'm so successful. If it wasn't for the Michael Evans mindset, you wouldn't have too much of nothing. You should be embarrassed. I was a little boy, and I wanted to join the fight. Because I didn't want, look, I'm a little boy. 7, 8 years old, I believe. I'm a little boy. I want to join the fight. Matter of fact, there were children that stood up in the civil rights movement. Children, where were the parents? Where was the adults? If we as a people, I'm not talking about a few thousand individuals, we as a people stood up, who knows where the hell we would be today? A bunch of lazy ass cowards. But then you'll benefit from somebody else suffering and death. That's why I'm gonna fight for my people. The hell with my people. You don't want to fight for yourself. You don't want to do nothing for yourself. Well, you stay exactly where you at. I watched a documentary about the Montgomery boycott. You have to applaud them. You have to applaud them. They suffered. Some was killed. I know Dr. King's house was bombed. The boycott lasted almost 2 years, a year and a half or something like that. You can't get these Negroes to boycott nothing. Why don't we boycott the Super Bowl? Oh, no, we can't do that. Okay, but you can't get these people to boycott nothing. But if you get enough to boycott and change something, they would be happy to benefit from it. Oh, no, not with me. Oh, no, not with me. It's not going to happen. We should be tired. We should be tired of people getting over on us. Not only foreigners, but our own lazy ass, trifling ass people. Skinning and grinning. But see, when you ain't done nothing yourself, you don't care. When you ain't suffered and did nothing. That's why these are out here. They never had to suffer for nothing. That's why some of these old spoiled children y'all got. You give them everything that you want so they don't appreciate nothing. You buy them a car. You rent their apartment so they can go to school, to college. You spoil the hell. They don't have to do a damn thing. And next thing you know, your ass in a nursing home. Because they don't have the time to take care of mommy and daddy at home. Go to a nursing home. And the children move away. That's the excuse because they don't want to take care of your old sick ass and put you in a nursing home. That's what your children that you love and you spoil, that's what they do, put you in a nursing home. So get ready. Get your spot. You can even prepay for it, because that's where you're going to end up at, because your children are not going to do a damn thing for you. They too busy for your sick, can't walk no more ass. Can't do nothing for them. People only love us when we can do something for them. The reason why these foreigners, these black foreigners, pretend like they love black folks in America, so because they getting over on us. I want to know about your history. Keep repeating mine. I already know mine. We know ours. What about your struggle? And then you have all this advice for me. You have a country. I'm a black American. I'm a soul brother. I'm a foundational black American. I am a freedman in this country. I don't have no nation I can run to. You have a nation. You got Haiti. You got Grenada. You got Barbados. You got the Congo, wherever the hell you came from. Since you so smart and you got it on like that, why don't you take your happy ass back to where you come from? You can, because that's where you come from. I didn't come from Africa. I have no interest. I wish people in Africa the best of luck. But the leaders of Africa want to be like white people. The leaders are corrupt in Africa. They want swimming pools, 300 pairs of shoes they can't wear, fancy car. They want to be like white folks. Y'all all messed up. Go straighten your own country up. You got the Caucasian women here who have also taken advantage of the civil rights movement. Because civil rights legislation was supposed to be for black Americans. The foundation of black Americans, the freedmen, soul brothers and sisters. That's what it was supposed to be for.
and they flipped around and changed it up and gave it to other folks. Then, of course, you know, we became minorities. These slick ass folks. But they done it because we let them do it. Because we was comfortable with the scraps we already got. This generation. The baby boomer generation and those who came after us, we let all this happen. We don't have nothing. And y'all get on airplanes and fly to the Super Bowl living this illusion like you part of something. Then sooner or later we get our wake-up calls. It's not real. Just like the cows going to the slaughterhouse. Have no idea they on their way to the slaughterhouse. They just being cows. Moving. That's all. Well, you they can even hear. I don't know how many of y'all ever been to a slaughterhouse, and you can hear those machines grinding and you can hear some of those cows room room because that's their last moo. And the other cows waiting to get in line, they just out there. Moo. Moo. It ain't even no grass to eat. Go to a slaughterhouse. There's no grass to eat. I don't know what the hell they chewing on. And it stink. Next thing you know. And then if you want some kosher meat, the kosher butcher, what they do, they take their time to pet the animal or whatever. Next thing you know, slice their throat. Don't even know you're going to die at all. One method, you see the other cow in front of you. Oh, did you see what happened to Charlie? The other method, they nice. I'm going to get out of here, y'all. The other method is they're nice to you. Pet you. Make you feel good, then all of a sudden, slice your throat. Wow. This is what we're facing. Now, if foreign black people want to join the effort and join the struggle and bleed and die on the battlefield, as our ancestors, I have no problem with that. They're not doing it. They're taking our information, they're taking our struggle and making money off of it and benefiting from it. And giving you and me nothing. Matter of fact, they would turn around and tell us what we're doing wrong. What the hell? You giving me my information. You living off my struggle, my suffering, and you don't tell me what I need to do. Well, why didn't you, since you're so damn smart, why didn't you do that in your own damn country, sir, ma'am? Can't teach me nothing. It's sad. I give credit where credit is due to the Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey. But he exploited. He was unable to get his own people to do nothing, and they're not doing nothing to this day. But they always come and target us because it looked like we got a target on our back. Well, what made him think, oh, I can't get my own Jamaicans to follow me and do this? Let me go to America. Because everybody knows that black people in America the Negro, the descendant of the slave, they know we gullible for anything. We will embrace anything except what's real. That's why. Master Farah Muhammad came to the black community because he knew that we was gullible. These people come to us because they know that we gullible. We eat up any damn thing.
We're talking about not falling into the teacher trap, not falling into the website trap. So today, what teachers can you learn from? We just told you that the Aka Wu tells you that we're all the great teacher at the same time. So who you gonna learn from? You're gonna learn from brothers like Sarnetta. You're gonna learn the positives and negatives from brothers like Sarnetta. You're gonna learn the positives and negatives of people like Brother Polite. The positives and negatives of people like Sarah Sutton Seti. You're gonna learn from Maurice Muhammad, Talik Ibn Rod. You're gonna learn from Netter Cat. You're gonna learn, you definitely gonna learn from King Noble. You definitely gonna learn a little something something from Brother Daku.
Yes. I want that. Oh, I need that. Got to have that. It's me.
Dragon Manifest. Welcome to the Reality Tip on Earth, Dragon Manifest.
Thank you, thank you, thank you for having me, brother. This is an honor. When I first saw your channel, I said, oh, this is an ancestor that has most definitely returned. Yes, most sir. Definitely. This is not a new ancestor. This is an old ancestor. you could hear, you could feel the ancestors through you. You know, most people probably say, what is he talking about?
Right.
They don't get it. You gotta be on that level.
If you say that I'm divine and I'm a prophet, where the hell did your ass go to? Why aren't you heeding the call? Since I'm a prophet, since I'm divine. Some people, excuse the language, some people just like talking out their ass. 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 That's what they like to do.
Peace forever and always. My black people, it's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving.
About Black History Month, and I'm looking at this history, and as you know, many of you know, it was originally called Negro History Week, created by Carter G. Woodson, correct? Carter G. Woodson. It was originally called Negro History Week. Who is the Negro? The week was dedicated to the Negro, who is now called African American, who is called Black American today. It did not mention no history outside of America. Our news station and yours, celebrating Black History Month, I don't see them putting up pictures of Kemet and Africans and none of that stuff. It's all about the foundation of Black American, all about the freedmen, all about soul brothers and sisters in this country, the Black American. That's who it's about. I don't even think they mentioned Marcus Garvey, which Marcus Garvey was not a Black American. He introduced something called Pan-Africanism to us. I don't think that Marcus Garvey created it, but he introduced something called Pan-Africanism. But it's supposed to be, Black History Month is supposed to be dedicated to these who are born in America. But I noticed that foreign blacks or melanated people, they seem to me take over our history. They talk about Malcolm X, they talk about Dr. King, they talk about the Black Panther. Please correct me. Help me if I'm going off the beaten path. If I'm wrong, where was these people? Because I don't remember seeing them. I heard about them, foreign Black people in New York, and maybe in California somewhere. I was born and raised in Jim Crow South, Mississippi. I don't remember seeing or hearing nothing about them. I don't remember them being bit by dogs, sprayed with water hoses. I don't remember them going to jail with Dr. King. Where these people come from? Where they at? I don't remember them being with Elijah Muhammad when he went to jail for 5 years. And here they come teaching us our history, selling books and tapes about our history. Where, okay, if it's Black history and you want to be part of it, and you come from a foreign country and you are oppressed, wherever you come from, where is your history? Why aren't they teaching about the oppression in Haiti or Grenada or the wherever they come from? Someplace in Africa? The only thing they talk about in teaching and concentrating on is Black history, Black American history. What about you? I don't know about you. Talk about you oppressed just like we are, and the Spanish oppressed you, whatever. Why aren't you talking about it? You praising Malcolm and Elijah Muhammad and Dr. King and Frederick Douglass and all. What about, where's your part? That's why I don't know nothing about them, because they're not talking about them. Well, that's because, see, it all goes back to the money, because you cannot make any money. It's about exploitation of us. We will buy the books. We will go to the debates to learn and hear about ourselves. They ain't gonna do it, because they're not gonna pay to learn about themselves like that. All those debates that Sarnetta had set up, whatever, it's all about, it's all founded on us. None of this foreign stuff. Sarnetta is supposed to be a Dominican, right? why he joined Khalid Muhammad. You come from Dominican Republic. Where is your version from the Dominican of Khalid Muhammad, sir? Why do they rally around our people and our struggle? Cause, and they make money off of us. It's all about money. It's not about respect for us. It's all about making, exploiting our struggle. We had the civil rights movement. Our ancestors couldn't take it no more. So they created something called the civil rights movement. And overall, it was called the Black Revolution. Has there been a Chinese revolution in this country? A Dominican revolution in this country? Or a Haitian revolution in this country? Or a Japanese or an et cetera, Mexican, et cetera, et cetera, Latin American revolution in this country? Has it? They didn't have to. Because they riding off our ancestors' back. This has nothing to do with hatred. This is a fact. No, the hater are those who ride in the back of our ancestors. I'm supposed to sit back and be quiet? All these people don't have to fight because they take advantage of the things that our ancestors fought and died for. Then these black foreigners turn around and sell it back to you. Donate to my Cash App. I'm not even a black American. I'm from a Dominican. I'm a Dominican from some damn where. They have no teachings of their own. Everything they got come from us. Then they sell it back to us. Tell us about your struggle. They're not going to tell us about their struggle because they nobody interested enough to sell it. Everybody is out to exploit us. Everybody is out to parasite off us. I don't want to hear about that African stuff. I don't want to hear about because you black. I'm glad those brothers and sisters, people in the Dominican say I'm not black. I'm Dominican. Because they're not us. We can be of the same race, whatever the hell that is, but we are in different tribes and families. What is it? I think the Quran said that Allah made us in different tribes and families so that we would know one another. This is our family. And we have this delusional fairy tale mind that everybody love us. You have the same mindset with these black foreigners as you done with white folks, because the white folks, we love everybody. And so you think now you don't want to include the white folks. All the black people love us. That's a damn lie. They love you because they can get something off of you. They can exploit you. All these people I'm learning, not even black American. They come from some island somewhere, whatever. They don't do nothing for us. If it wasn't for us, they couldn't do what they do. Then they'll turn around and talk about us. And we tolerate it. That's our family. They are not us. They don't give a damn about us like that. Why couldn't they stay in their own land and solve their problem? They gonna come here and tell us, the black man and woman, what we should and should not be doing. Why do you do that in your own damn country? If I'm incorrect, please put it in the chat room. You don't have to agree with me. And I won't get upset with you. I would like to ask you, what's up? They want to be our teacher. You stole our information from our scholars, from our movement, our struggle. Then you sell it back to us. Bunch of creeps. all these suckers take advantage of the struggle from what our ancestors. I'm angry and upset about that because I grew up in Jim Crow. And you can go anywhere on YouTube. I was raised in the state of Mississippi. I know what our ancestors, I know what we went through. And we're going to sit back and let these other people leech off of us. Not only I don't want them people leeching off of us, I don't like the fact that other black people that don't do a damn thing, they benefit. I don't like that either. Not just them. I was a little boy. And I asked my mother, grandfather, uncles. I was a little boy when I began to learn what Jim Crow was. I began to learn what was going on in the South. And I learned about Dr. King. That was the first person I learned about. And by the time I learned about Dr. King, he was passed. He was assassinated in 1968. But I asked my people, what did y'all do to help? What did y'all do in the struggle? Because I was a little boy, as soon as I learned, I'm ready to join the struggle. I'm ready to fight. It reminds me, matter of fact, this is the 50th anniversary of Good Times. Ain't we lucky? The Super Bowl, y'all. Ain't we lucky we got them? Do, 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 do. Good Times. Super Bowl, y'all. Yeah, will you shut up so I can go watch the... It's time for the Super Bowl. I want to see them play with some balls. This is the 50th anniversary of Good Time. And if you notice, Michael Evans, they never took little Michael serious. He was somebody to laugh at. Oh, that's Michael. He's pro-blackity black this, and that's Michael. The whole family. Nobody could get with what Michael was on. He was a little boy. He was a little boy. And this is the way it was, really, us as a people. A few people stood up. And the rest was Christian, like Florida and James and Thelma and JJ and Wilona. They didn't care about the struggle. They laughed at little Michael. When I first saw Good Times, I took Michael real serious. And I'm like, what are they laughing at? Why are they laughing at Michael for? But see, if it wasn't for that mindset of Michael, if it wasn't for the mindset of Dr. King and the Black Panthers, Huey P. Newton and Elvis Cleavage and all, if it wasn't for that mindset, where would we be? Where would we be at? But he's a subject of laughter. What is Michael doing funny? What's hilarious? So I asked my family, what did we do? What did y'all do for the struggle? Ain't do nothing. But Thelma and JJ and Florida and Wilona and James and all the Negroes benefit from the struggle, but didn't do a damn thing. Even to this day. Even to this day, all our people, rappers and singers and CEOs or whatever, I'm so successful. If it wasn't for the Michael Evans mindset, you wouldn't have too much of nothing. You should be embarrassed. I was a little boy, and I wanted to join the fight because I didn't want, look, I'm a little boy. 7, 8 years old, I believe. I'm a little boy. I want to join the fight. Matter of fact, there were children that stood up in the civil rights movement. Children. Where were the parents? Where was the adults? If we as a people, I'm not talking about a few thousand individuals, we as a people stood up, who knows where the hell we would be today? A bunch of lazy ass cowards. But then you'll benefit from somebody else suffering and death. That's why I'm no longer, I'm going to fight for my people. To hell with my people.
We are in a state of emergency.
Prejudice. Wrote a song about it? Like to hear it? Here it go.
Free your mind.
Keep it real.
What, dear?
Because I keeps it real like that.
I keeps it real.
Everything is satisfaction.
He's heading your way again. Uncle Remus, the immortal storyteller in Walt Disney's honored motion picture classic.
Now that's the kind of day when you can't open your mouth without a song jump right out of it. Zip-a-dee-doo-dah, zip-a-dee-ay. My, oh my, what a wonderful day.
Singing a song, a song about sound.
By Brother Angel Snubnub 7 at the Reality Temple. And to give props to him, because I listen to all of Angel Snubnub 7's videos, I think that he comes from a different angle. And there's a powerful message in a lot of the videos that he put out, and I try to catch all of them. I look at him as a free thinker and a person that's willing to challenge those of which he don't agree with or which he may think differently from, and I really respect him for that. He's challenged KNBS, and he has also challenged the black supremacy movement as well. And I have nothing against that, because that which cannot be challenged cannot stand and will not stand and will not survive the test of time. How many challenges we can withstand will determine how long we will be able to stand.
Himself, and you don't realize it. You don't realize it that God has been imprisoned. The devil was able to imprison God. So right inside your own self, your God self has been imprisoned, and you have a false sense of self running rampant inside the temple. This is why You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
We have to bring reality temple here on earth. Reality temple here on earth.
Yes, sir.
We have to realize the enemy is running rampant inside this temple.
I keep it real.
What, dear?
Because I keeps it real like that.
I keeps it real.
We don't look at the whole picture of nothing. Tastes good, make me feel good. We don't think. And when you become emotional, it gets even worse, because emotion, whether it's happy, sad, frustrated, however you feel, that emotion affects your thinking process. That's why many people commit suicide. Based on emotion, not on how can I solve my problem. It's based upon emotion. She don't love me. Why she break up with me? I have no reason to live. Based upon emotion. You don't hear any logic. All emotion. I can't live without her. What does she see in him that I couldn't give her? All emotion. No logic. I don't want to live without her. Kabang. It's all emotion. No logic. No thought. No thinking. Nothing out. Just emotion. Emotion brings improper thinking. Now, I have lived on this planet a little while. And this generation of social media, they've probably been out there all the time. But social media exposes so much, the bad and the good. And what I have seen because of social media, so many younger people, because a lot of older people like myself, many of them don't use social media like that unless they're celebrities trying to make money or, you know, trying to keep their name out there in the public. A lot of older people like myself, I don't see a lot of them not interested in social media, don't care. But we know that it's the younger folks, probably between 18 and on up or whatever, and even younger. Well, I'm not going to talk about the younger because they're children. I've never seen so-called adults, especially men. And on this platform, I've had my experience with so-called men. They get so upset real quick because you disagree with what they're talking about. You're a coon, you're a Sambo, you weak, you blah, blah. What? Because I disagree with what you're talking about? And then they express that weakness. Then they talk about how weak women are. I've never been around such weak men in my life. They cry and they wimpy. What do women do? And the women's weak. What kind of man gonna spend time talking about women's weaves and their makeup? I guess what kind of panties they wear. But these men do. The women shouldn't wear weaves. So the women decide, how about we just cut all our hair off? Be like Snuff. You shouldn't cut all your hair. You're not going to win with them. even with the natural hair. Why you gotta wear your hair? What, you said you want natural hair? Yeah, but that's the wrong. You're not going to win with them. They complain. They complain to keep, it's a distraction tactic to keep the pressure off them because they know that they don't qualify as no man in this country. You are called a man by default.
Well, that's it. I can't listen to this. This man talking real crazy.
Because you think you're a man. You're not no damn man. You're a man by default simply because you have a penis. Making babies don't make you a man. Dogs make puppies. Chickens make chicks all day long. So what? You're going to run your ass to the Super Bowl, but you don't control a damn thing about the Super Bowl, Mr. Man. You run your happy ass up and down the football field, and the people that control the Super Bowl just sit back and watch. You got to work for your $1 million. You got to work. You got to be careful that you don't get brain damage, your body broken to pieces for your $1 million. And your massa sit up just like, what's his name? Colin Kaepernick, whatever his name is. He said it's like slavery. And when they have that draft, the owners come out and basically it's like like you on the block. There are some that don't like Colin Kaepernick or whatever his name is, whatever. But that's, he's telling you from experience. How many points you made last year? How big you are? Just like you was on the block on a slave plantation. And all the team owners gather around, pick their new buck. You, Mr. Man. And so since you cannot compete with the men in authority, the only thing you can do is exploit women. Find you some woman that you can exploit. Make it rain. The women in the strip club, find a way to exploit somebody so you don't feel bad about yourself getting stroked in the behind by other men. With your tight pants going up, la-di-da, up and down the field, catching balls. What you getting angry at me for? That's what they doing, you're catching balls. Y'all like playing with balls. You mean y'all like playing with balls? Basketball, football, tennis ball, golf ball, long as a ball. Y'all some, and you think that you ain't nothing gay about it. The slave master got y'all playing with balls. Mr. Man, I'm a man. And some of these guys make millions of dollars and still don't pay their child support like they're supposed to. Making all these, I got 10, 12 baby. Gotta go to court. Because that's all you got. You don't control nothing. You're just something to use. And no matter where you go, you're going to get used. When you go to Africa, you're going to get used by them. When you can go to Europe, you're going to get used. You can go to Antarctica. You can go live with an Eskimo. You're going to get used. Mr. Man. And we act on emotion. Everything about these modern day men is emotional. Why are you unsubscribing from Angel Snuff Nuff 7? It's based on emotion. It's not based upon, am I bringing something logical? Is, Is the argument that I'm making, is it valid? It's based on emotion. Now, here we are. We're in the age of information. We can get basic information. It don't have to be technical. We can get basic information just by going to the computer real quick. A fella told me, because I said, I was talking about how black men, we don't have a military. And his excuse was, how are we going to have a military? We don't have a nation. Where is it written? Why we can't have a military? Why do we have to have a nation? Where is that? Show me where there's a nation that don't have a military. So I just went on Google, and it was 20 countries that don't have a military. Then, I forgot what you call them. You also have military for hire. They don't have a nation. They will go. Matter of fact, Russia has some of those guys. Military for hire. They don't have no nation. If you pay the price, they will fight for you. I forgot what you call those kind of people. Military for hire. It's a name for them. I forgot what you call them. Anyway, somebody in the chat room probably will bring it. What is it? A military for hire. What do you call those type of... It's at the tip of my tongue. I can't think of what it is. It's when you pay somebody to fight for you. And see, that's another thing. If we had our act together, we could do the same thing. Y'all scary ass. Get your money together, and you can hire some people to fight for you. But you don't want to fight at all because it's going to interrupt you and your system that you love. You're just a bunch of talk. You're just talking. I put up the link in a minute, Brother Jesus, I cannot get your name. I'm going to put the link up in a second here. Well, a little bit, because I was planning on doing this. I really didn't expect nobody to join, but I put up the link in a minute here. I'm doing my commentary. Thank you for joining us. Super Bowl. Improper thinking. Because we're emotional. You don't act like men. And the reason why you don't act like men, because you never had to be a man. That's a whole different subject. I have that live stream later on this week or something like that. I want to talk about this relationship between black men and women. I want to talk about that. I'm not going to get into that. But how you gonna be a man and you never had to be a man or act like a man for 300 years, not for 3 months, not for 30 days, not for 30 years. You never had to be a man. What the hell do you know about being some man? And when did you become a man? Cause they was kicking your ass for 300 years. You damn sure wasn't a man on the slave plantation, and you damn sure wasn't a man during Jim Crow. When did y'all become these strong warrior men? And what war did y'all fight, y'all warriors? What war did you fight? Improper thinking. I began to question this warrior God stuff based on emotion. At one time. Because it sound good. But when you really think about it. What did I do? What's my power as a God? I'm a God. What's my power as a man? I began to think of these things realistically. Outside emotion. It's not true. It's not real. But emotion causes improper thinking because it makes you feel good. but it's not real. The Super Bowl, black, whites, Mexicans, all the folks get together, we watch it, that's not real. This country is no melting pot like that. Only for entertainment, for sports, for foolishness. Because they control all of it. You don't control nothing. The only people that control the Super Bowl are the white people of this country. People of color don't control the Super Bowl. All that you do is run your happy ass up and down the field and pay your money to go see. That's all you gonna do. You don't control and run nothing. Mr. Man, we don't think. There's an old saying called, look before you leap. How many of you have heard of that old saying? Look before you leap. Many of us, we don't look. We just leap because it sounds good. It looks good. We chase a woman because she got a big booty. She look good. And you leap. I remember as a child, I was a teenager. We went down to the river. And it looked like you could just jump into the water.
Let's see, Talik says, can you send a shout out to my platform, the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry? Our theme this year is After Purge Comes the Healing. So shout out to your platform, Talik. All the best to you guys with continuing to stretch in perspective, to stretch in what is possible, and to continue to bring healing into the space of yourself and others. Yes.
My black people, it's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving me. Like that, the king, we make it plain and simple. Bringing knowledge and fire at Reality's Temple. Reality's Temple. My black people, it's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving me. Like that, the king, we make it plain and simple. Bringing knowledge and fire.
The future goes to the people who plan it, right? That's a Malcolm X quote, not exact, but he said something along those lines. So the future goes to people that prepare for today, you know? So what is being prepared as far as a power dynamic is pink people perish, you know, and then this sort of false white supremacy.
Long Talk Radio /2Rock TV, man.
Thank you. on these same stations. And you can bet the last money, it's all gonna be a stone gas, honey. I'm Don Cornelius, and as always, in parting, we wish you love, peace, and soul.